then begin your remarks by answering the question, can you operate within the mayor's proposed budget? Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have with me today, on my left, Jimmy Clary, who is our chief deputy and operations manager. And on my right, I have David Diaz-Barriga, who is our assessment manager, the deputy in charge of administration. And the answer is that we can live within the mayor's proposed budget this year.
Thank you. You're welcome to make any other remarks you wish about your department and the good work you're doing.
I appreciate it. And I just wanted to say, make a few brief comments. We completed the 2013 reappraisal program last year. It had a very successful result, and I wanted to thank the council members who helped us extensively in getting together meetings that helped inform the public about that process and that program. And as a result, I think we did a good job of communicating to the public, which on top of some pretty stable real estate markets ended up producing the fewest number of appeals that we've had after a reappraisal program in a number of years. We've just completed the 2017 assessment roll and are ready to hand it over to the Board of Equalization. And we are about ready to begin the appeals process for that role. We've opened our call center, and so far we've had very few calls, and I anticipate we're going to have few appeals this year as well. So that's good news for us. And also wanted to thank this body for the funding and support that they've given to our office over the years. Hopefully we're using that funding wisely, and I just wanted to mention that in 2013 we received an award from the International Association of Assessing Officers, and we were the distinguished assessment jurisdiction in North America. So we feel like we're doing a good job, and I want to thank the staff at the office for making that happen, and thank this body and the mayor for funding and supporting our office. And with that, I'll be happy to take any questions that anyone has.
Thank you. Councilman Tigert.
Thank you, and welcome, George, and able staff. Explain a little bit about the appeals process, what citizens have the right, and what the procedure is, and the data that they need if they feel like there's a mistake made.
Right. This year, in 2014, we have a non-reappraisal year. So notices are mailed out only to property owners who have had a change in their assessment this year. So it was, instead of mailing out 250,000 notices this year, we probably mailed out about 10,000, 12,000 notices to property owners where their values have changed. They will have an opportunity to contact our office and set up a hearing with a hearing officer in June, or with the full Board of Equalization in late June or early July. So if just because you didn't get a change, or just because you didn't have a notice, doesn't mean you don't have the right to appeal. So anyone who has a concern or a question about their appraisal or assessment, we encourage them to call our office and talk to us. Our number is 862-6080. 862-6059 in the call center, and we'll be happy to help anyone with a question or a concern that they have about their assessment.
Okay, so if someone missed their appeal process last year, but time-wise, that doesn't mean that they can't appeal this year.
That's correct. They can appeal for this 2014 year, and they can they can't go back retroactively for last year, but they do have an opportunity this year to appeal.
To go forward.
Hopefully, most of those people have contacted us when they realized they missed that deadline, and we've already resolved those issues, because we had a period before the appeal period where the taxpayers could informally contact our office and we could review those.
I think it's important that citizens are aware of that and that right.
Yeah, because the important thing, as you know, is that once the deadline passes, and the deadline this year is going to be June the 20th. So if once that June 20th deadline passes, there's really very little that we can do to get somebody before a body that can hear the matter.
Okay, and you have a tool out on the Nashville.gov web page called WebPro that gives you all the data on your property and sales of surrounding property and what your neighbor's property, and all this information that would help someone determine if a mistake has been made.
Right, and all that information is available online. You can get to it through Nashville.gov. We have all the physical characteristics of all properties available out there on WebPro, so you can look at the important thing for the property owner is for them to look at their property description, make sure it's accurate. That's the first thing that I would recommend anyone do. If we have an inaccuracy, then they need to point that out to us, and we can resolve that likely with very little difficulty. Also, there are other tools out there available to that. We have a comp or sale search tool that allows you to look at comparable sales in your area. You can see what the market's doing, what other properties that are similar to yours close by are selling for, and you can make a pretty good determination as to what the value of your property is based on what other properties are selling for. So all that information is available. It's pretty easy to use, fairly user-friendly. You can actually compile that into a report easily, and you can print it out and bring it to us and say, here are the sales that I think are the most comparable to my property, and they indicate that the value should be this amount. So,
okay. You're losing two positions, I understand, in this, and there was some notice about potentially affecting the service level. What areas of service would be affected?
The we believe that these are two vacant positions that we have left vacant because we believe that we can continue to provide a reasonable level of service without these positions. And I don't really anticipate any dramatic reductions in service or any significant changes in the way we do business. Anytime you lose positions, as you know, it can be challenging to make up the difference, because certainly we're going to have to distribute that work elsewhere or use technology to improve our processes to make up the difference. One of the things that we've done that I believe has really been helpful is be able to retain and train and retain good employees, and we've really emphasized training and education, and we've had a number of employees over the last couple of years that have received their designations and certifications. We believe that makes them more competent, more capable, and we believe they're actually doing a really good job for us. So I want to commend our staff, and because really they're picking up the slack. It's we've been able to attribute a lot of the efficiency gains and efficiencies to new technologies and better technologies, and I think that is true. But I actually am seeing recently more of a I believe a situation where staff is picking up additional workload, and they're doing more, producing more, being more productive, and I'm grateful to them for that, and that's what's allowed us to improve our efficiency.
Final suggestion, your icon for WebPro used to be a big old one on the page. Now your picture's bigger than it, and it distracts me. It's harder to find. So
okay,
tell Mr. Durbin we'd like to reduce your picture and make WebPro bigger.
Thank
we'll
you,
do.
Councilman.
We'll do.
Councilman Berry.
Thank you, Chair. How are you all? It's great to see you. Thanks for being here. And I wanted to echo Councilman Tigard's WebPro shout out. It's fun to spend a lot of time on that. It's got lots of great information. I wanted to pick up on the two vacant positions. Because you are eliminating them and they haven't been filled, how long have they actually been vacant?
These positions have been vacant for probably most of this fiscal year.
Okay, so that absorption.
For a while.
Okay, so the absorption of other duties, et cetera, isn't going to negatively impact other workers. I mean, this has already been basically allocated.
The work has been allocated. They might question whether or not that's negatively impacted them, but we're getting the work done.
Right, absolutely. Well, again, it's always whenever you see elimination of positions, you just want to make sure that there's enough staff to do what the public expects. So right. I appreciate the answer.
Yes.
Thank you, Councilwoman Weiner. Sorry, there you go.
Hello. Thank you, Chair. I want to thank you for the great, respectful staff that you've got. We had firsthand experience yesterday with your visual inspection. They were in our neighborhood, and they were quite thorough and quite polite. So several of the neighbors wanted me to commend you on that. So thank you.
Thank you. That's great to hear.
Yeah, they did a really good job, I thought. So my first question is, and I'm sorry if it may be a duplication, I was out dealing with some district business, Charlie may have already asked, but where do you see the largest percentage of increase in the increases in property values around Nashville?
Well, the actual values are updated during the reappraisal program. Those values tended to increase the most in, to simplify it, pretty close to downtown. The further away you got from downtown towards the county line, the less dramatic the increases in value. So the areas like East Nashville and Belmont and Sylvan Park and areas like that residentially experienced large increases. The commercial core experienced some pretty significant increases in commercial property. So the core of the city is pretty hot. And when you get out into areas like Goodlettsville, Jolton, Hermitage, areas like that, you're not seeing as large an increase in value. But the market seems to be improving generally across the county. It's just doing even better in the core. We do sales ratio studies monthly in the office, which is a comparison of what current sales prices are to the values that we put on the properties in January of last year. And what we've seen is that our values are already in some cases anywhere from 6 to 8% low because we're not updating them until the next reappraisal program. So the prices that we're seeing in the sales of property have increased pretty dramatically over the course of the last year.
Okay, great, thank you.
Following the same trend that we saw in the reappraisal program.
Okay. My last question is, how has efficiency and expense been impacted, or how do you see it will be impacted by the use of new technologies that are out there?
Well, I can tell you that the biggest technology gain that we've seen in the last few years has been just our ability to be able to do inspections of property sitting in our desk. Just a few years ago, we had people in vehicles that got in the car every morning, drove out, rode down the street, did inspections of properties every day. And now they just simply come to the office, and because we have access to oblique aerial imagery that we pay for, and we pay a pretty good price for it, But nevertheless, the use of that imagery to do inspections, I think, has not only increased efficiency, I think it's improved the quality of our inspections. We're finding things out about property, discovering things, and we're using the aerial photography that we might not have discovered from the street level, because we can see all the way around the house, and we can actually do a better job of inspecting the property. And so our ability to do inspections has really the number of inspections that can be done on any given day has gone up tremendously.
So what are the criteria for him to have come knocking on my door?
Well, there was probably some sort of activity, a building activity, or there was they spotted something when they did that inspection in the office that alerted them that some change may have been made. We don't pick up changes from the aerial photography. If we notice a change or we detect some difference in the property as a result of that visual inspection using aerial photography, we then send somebody to the field to collect that data on the ground, because we don't want to get into guesswork looking at the photography. But just having that access to that photography to identify changes means that we don't have to visit most properties every year.
Thank you.
Councilman Claiborne.
George, this is a quick question. Last year you were talking about WebPro and all of the different capabilities and exploring additional things. So I just wanted to ask, are you looking at adding anything to what WebPro currently does in the coming year?
Yes, we are, and we've spent a lot of time over the course of the last few months since we completed the reappraisal program, just looking at what information is available and how we should make that available to the public. And we've been working with a couple of our vendors that run the systems that house that data to try to help them understand what we need and what we feel like is useful to the public, and we're going to work with them to help improve those products and make more data available and to make more analysis available. We had a meeting today about trying to give the public the ability to go out and do advanced searches for properties. So if you wanted to narrow a search down to a particular property type, property size, square footage, type construction, geographic area, define your own area, all those things that we can do in-house currently, we're trying to make that available to the public as well. So if anybody has any suggestions or ideas about what good uses we could make available to the public, we're happy to consider those and would like to. So,
Councilman Bedney.
Thank you, Chair. I too want to congratulate the system you guys have and the excellent service that the people that work there provide. I also know for personal experience. I was just, I had a question that I asked for forgiveness from the chair for asking a question that is...
You know you're in trouble if you're asking forgiveness ahead of time.
Yeah,
go ahead.
I'm in trouble.
Okay.
So how do you deem that a property is commercial or residential so you can assess it at a different value? Is that something that you do by using zoning or how a business is registered?
It's based on the use of the property, and state law requires us. Actually, it's written into the state constitution to some degree that the classifications of property are set out in the state constitution. What constitutes that classification is set out in the statute, and we just have to apply that to properties. But it's based on the use, and typically it's pretty simple because we all have a pretty good idea of what a commercial use is. It's a business, and if it's a business use, then it's commercial. If it's somewhere that somebody lives, then it's usually thought of as residential. The where it gets confusing at times for the public and sometimes for us as well is that if you have certain types of residential property based on the use, it can be considered commercial. So if you have two or more rental units, then it's commercial property. That's been taken to court in a lot of different cases, and we also have a lot of case law that establishes rules about what is commercial and residential in terms of residential properties. An apartment complex is clearly commercial. There's really not much of a question about that. But when you get down to, say, a duplex could be either commercial or residential, depending on whether there are two rental units. So if the owner happens to live in a duplex and only rents one side, it's a residential duplex. If the owner rents both sides, then it's a commercial duplex. And we've also gotten some interesting decisions from courts on condominiums, for example. If you have two or more condominium units in a complex, if they're not in the same building, they're residential. But if they all happen to be in the same building, they are they're commercial. So, it's difficult for us to administer in some cases, and it's difficult for the public to understand. And actually, sometimes the logic can be difficult to understand. But
I was wondering, in terms of an illegal business on a residence.
Pardon me, I'm sorry.
When you find an illegal business that is using a residence as a business.
If we found a business in a residence, if that was the primary function that was taking place in that building, then we would classify it as commercial. If it was a significant part of that building that was being used for a commercial purpose, we would do what we call a split classification, multiple classification, and we would classify the portion that was being used for business as commercial and the rest of it as residential. We don't find that very often, and perhaps it's even difficult to detect. A lot of people more and more do business from their homes, and if you've got a desk, this is a challenge for assessors across the state, and it's a topic of conversation for us at a lot of our meetings. But it can be challenging if somebody's got a desk in their bedroom and they use it for business at night.
Thank you for clarifying that, and thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Rooker. We appreciate your work.
All right, great. Thank you
very much. Lady Wynn, come on down.